and welcome to the Living Healthy Podcast. I'm Steve Mays, and here with us to talk about an interesting aspect of living healthy, our man, Dr. Henry Domke.
Good morning, Steve.
Folks ask me, you know, who have heard this show and who said, gosh, you know, it sounds like you guys are having fun. This Dr. Domke guy, who is this podcasting doctor thing? And today I thought it would be fun to let folks who, you know, those of us who are your patients already feel like we know you, but for folks who don't, a little bit about you and your medical practice and some of the things that you're involved in. So this is kind of a personal Henry Domke thing. Is that all right?
Yeah, it sounds great. I think if people might enjoy it, I don't know. If not, you can just press the stop button.
Yeah, I love referring to you as sort of my Renaissance buddy because not only are you, as anybody who listens to this show knows, a family practice physician, but you are an artist, and anybody who comes to your office will see lots of your art. Would you mind telling us a little bit about to what degree you mix your professional artistic career, and it is a very professional sort of thing, and your medical practice, and how do you find time for it all? And just tell us a little bit about what you're doing.
Well, I do take my art seriously as I take medicine seriously. I mean, those are I kind of see it as a dual career that I'm following, and I spend a tremendous amount of time in both, just about every single day. I mean, I've been doing this for years. I mean, I love art, and it's grown into a second business, which is booming. And I feel deeply passionate about art, and have I think my whole life.
But you were a doctor first.
How did you
get into this?
Well, I mean, I've always been interested in art. It goes back when I was a little kid, and I mean, in high school, I majored in art. I mean, that was my emphasis. And
you know, I should say at this point, let me interrupt you for a second. For folks who have an image who think, oh yeah, okay, here's a doctor who gets a little paint by numbers thing, and Dr. Domke is a nationally known artist, and we'll put some links on the website where you can go and see some more of his stuff. But so you as a kid, you were interested in this?
Always interested, and it's just never faded, you know. And but I also deeply love medicine, and you know, at the end of high school, I had assumed that I would go into art, and had enrolled in art school, but made a detour and changed my mind and said, you know, I think I would prefer to be a physician.
And so really? Yeah. Those seem so far apart.
They are. They're really far apart, but they both coexist within me. And so it's like, no, I don't think I want to be an artist. I think I'm going to pursue the path of being a physician, which I did, and I've been down that path for some decades. But the interest in art never faded. So it's grown back.
Well, must have come back. Was there a time at which one day you got up and said, you know what? I want to do the art thing again.
Well, I'd say it's simmered. You know, it's simmered in the back burner, and you know, it never stopped bubbling. But it kind of came. You know, it became more intense at times. When I first started to when I first got exposed to photography seriously, as I worked overseas for a year in New Guinea and New Zealand and Kenya, a close friend of mine, Nick Kelsch, kind of got me going with photography for that trip, which I really hadn't thought about, but he encouraged me to be serious about photography. And I found that year when I was working as a medical student overseas that I loved photography.
Now, were you not seriously into photography prior to that? I mean,
not seriously.
I mean, you took
casually,
pictures.
Yeah, okay. I took pictures, but this was like, you know, serious, you know, interchangeable lenses, tripods, rolling my own film, processing my film, printing. And so it was much more serious, and I found I loved it, and it really fit with my travels at that point. But then it kind of simmered down again as I went into, you know, my residency for family practice, and, you know, you just can't do them both at the same time. But then my brother-in-law got an Apple Lisa, which is the predecessor to the Macintosh.
Okay. back. Now, about what time? Was this in the 80s?
80s.
Okay.
Yeah, mid-80s, I guess.
So you got out of medical school, you got back in, you started your practice, and you practiced medicine for some years?
Some years.
Okay.
Uh-huh. So, yeah, some years, and...
And then the Apple-Lisa came out.
Then the Apple-Lisa came out, and you know, it had this visual, this graphical user interface, and technical things never really bothered me at all, and so... That was kind of intriguing that you could combine, you know, they had this drawing program and painting program on the computer back then. And it was like, wow, this is interesting. I mean, it was really, you know, junky by today's standards, but it was still really cool. And so that kind of drew me in and I started, you know, thinking about, you know, digital imaging and learning about computers. And that simmered through the 80s into the 90s. I don't remember the... First time I saw a demonstration at Apple headquarters in Kansas City of Photoshop before it came out.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
One of the early...
Before version one, it was like the beta of one at Apple headquarters back... It must have been the late 80s, maybe 89.
Okay.
Or maybe 1990, I'm not sure. But anyhow, I knew that was a real thing, you know, when I saw that, the beta version of Photoshop. Which, if you don't know, if our listeners don't know, Photoshop is really the only, you know, serious digital imaging software on the planet Earth. I mean, it controls the planet. But anyhow,
you saw this and immediately saw the sort of the artistic possibilities for you.
Well, somehow it just called me. I don't know. It's like, wow, there's real possibilities here. It's like a light bulb went off. You know, it's like, wow. You know, it's like instantly I knew this was a good thing, and so. So, but at that point, you know, it was just, that's cool. And I just kind of followed along with it, you know, not real serious.
Still a hobby at this point.
Still a hobby, clearly.
Okay.
But just an interest and something to mess with. And I don't know, though, the interest just kept building. I started doing more work with it, learning the program, you know, advancing my skills, and I knew that I wanted more, so I decided I'd go back and get some formal training.
Now, help us again. Give us a time reference here.
This is sliding through the 1990s.
Okay.
And so in the mid-1990s, I started to feel frustrated. Frustrated that I didn't really have any formal training in art. You know, it's real easy with art to be, with digital imaging, to be just kind of geeky, you know, to be technically competent or to play with filters in Photoshop, but to be artistic in any sense is more difficult. It's really a different way of thinking than to think about the technical stuff or the geeky stuff. So, I mean, and you can't get that from books very easily. So, like, how do you do this? So I started asking around and sending out emails to schools. And I don't know. I mean, I just wasn't sure what to do. But anyhow, through my art teacher from high school, I got going with a professor in New York City. Annette Weintraub, who is an internationally known digital artist and a web-based artist, and she agreed to teach me.
Wow! You just out of the blue, you contacted her and said, "I'm interested in this," and
I did, and she said, "Okay." And so we did. We conducted weekly telephone lessons, and then we followed up with the computer where I'd send images. And
at this time, you're still maintaining a full load in your medical practice?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay.
And so I'm just kind of, you know, she started to teach me and would do weekly things and lessons, and kind of she would help guide me, you know, as if she was teaching her students, but just one-on-one. And then she encouraged me to look more locally just so I could get more involved and have more hands-on, because New York City was too far away, although I did meet with her a few times, but... So I met a local painting professor, Bill Hawk, at the University of Missouri, and he kind of took on that role. And then he finally said, you know, Henry, if you're going to be serious about this, you should probably enter graduate school. And so this is getting into the, you know, maybe 1997. And so I hired another physician to share my practice so I could cut my time in half. And then I went to graduate school.
Now, when you say you cut your time in half, I mean, this is sort of interesting because that seems like a pretty drastic measure for a physician. I mean, you guys work hard to build your practices up, and you know, to some degree, the more patients, the better. I mean, as many as you can see and take care of. But you said, no, I'm going to stop a little bit?
I did. I said, yeah, let's cut it in half. You know, I mean, granted, it did cut my income in half.
Did some patients go away?
I did lose patients. I'm sure I did.
I mean, if you cut your practice in half, I mean, I was curious how you did that. I know it's not germane to this particular story, but, I mean, it was a big deal.
Well, it was a shared practice. I mean, I brought in this other physician, and kind of when I wasn't here, they were here, and so it was a shared practice.
All right. So this was a big life kind of change for you. I mean,
you
decided I'm going to make less money, and I'm going to go do something that I want to do.
Yeah, and frankly, I had been ratcheting back prior to that, you know, because I was spending more and more time anyhow.
Did you ever give any thought to saying, you know what, I'm just going to give up my medical practice?
Never, never.
That didn't occur to you?
No, never, okay. Not once. I mean, I love medicine. I do.
Obviously.
Yeah, I mean, I love medicine, and it's like, well, who says you have to do one or the other? I don't know where that rule is written. A lot of people assume that, though. So anyhow, so I did this graduate school thing, an MFA program, and it was wonderful. I focused on painting. Primarily, because I thought that painting was, for what I wanted, the classic art form that I wanted to be educated in. Even though I never really thought I would be a painter, I assumed I would go back to doing digital imaging and photography.
Now, did you have any sort of, what's the word I'm looking for, knack for painting? I mean,
yes. Yeah. I'm good with my hands. I mean, I have good hand-eye coordination, and I can technically I can draw really well, and I can paint well.
Okay, so you knew going in that you had those basic skills.
Yeah, because I knew that from high school.
Okay.
I mean, I was able – I mean, I knew I had just basic – I mean, that's not to say I was really great at it, but I mean,
you're credible. I mean
– Yeah. I mean, I can put, you know, somebody smiling, and they look like they're smiling.
But you can't write a decent signature on a prescription. No, I'm just saying.
It's legible to those that it matters to.
Okay. What I would love on the scripts is to see a nice little sketch.
Yeah. Okay. It is a sketch.
All right. So you're back in school now. You're getting a master's in fine arts. I'm trying to remember when I went to your first show.
I think you may have come to my first show. I had one in Legacy Art and Books in Columbia, the main gallery there.
I bought something.
Yeah, you did, I remember.
And that was your first show.
Well,
it was not my first.
Well, yeah, it was like 98 or 99.
Okay.
It was a while ago, Steve. But I actually had a couple smaller shows prior to that, I should say. That was the first show that, you know, had meaning to me.
So, do you remember a point at which people started buying your stuff? I mean, was that sort of any kind of a big moment for you to go, whoa, okay, you know?
Well, you know,
not only is it fun, but look, Ma.
Well, you know, I did not go into art because people will buy it, you know, because truthfully, you know, you just don't make it in art in general. So people never started buying my art, you know, back then. I mean, occasionally I have shows and sell a few things, but I mean, basically.
I definitely remember there were price tags on those pictures, Henry.
There were, but the truth is, you know, like most shows, you may not know this, but, you know, for most unknown artists, as I was, I mean, you just don't sell. You don't.
I mean, well, it's so competitive. I mean, there's so many people doing that.
So, I mean, I sold a few pieces here and there, but, I mean, it was kind of incidental, frankly. I mean, it was nice. It was. I felt encouraged because, you know, people were being supportive. But it was relatively a small deal at that point. And then, of course, the gallery, you know, they take half.
Ooh.
Yeah. And then you've already framed all those other pictures. And so, you know, virtually always a show ends up being a financial loss.
You know, this is we've definitely got to get folks to see. I wish we had are there links on your website, henrydomke.com, right?
Yeah, henrydomke.com.
To your earlier works, is there a way
There's a few that are buried in there. If you look under exotic, because some of my earliest works, I should say.
Because it's evolved.
Very different. Yeah, it was surrealistic, and some was surrealistic, some was more purely abstract.
I happen to be a fan of your earlier work, as we say in the art world.
Yeah.
I have some of your pieces, and I like that. But, you know, I think from a technical standpoint, and I'm not an artist, but just as a person who looks at your stuff, it looks like you have gotten technically more proficient.
Well, I have. And the machine – and the whole –
the technology.
There's been an explosion in the printing. Like the earlier prints that you bought, they were called iris prints, and that was sort of the state of the art then. And I sent them to San Francisco for printing, and they would FedEx them back to me, and, you know, very expensive. Whereas now I have my own print shop in my house where I do all my own art, and it's much better quality. It's archival.
Maybe this,
I don't have to use FedEx.
This is a good place to talk about how your subject matter changed from that rather abstract, kind of more, I want to think of digital subject matter. Somewhere along the way, we started seeing more and more, how do you describe it? Nature?
I take pictures in my backyard. Nature in my backyard. That's what I shoot now.
Well, that hardly captures the beauty of the stuff.
If folks, I have a pretty backyard.
Well, tell us a little bit about that. I mean, one day you said, you know, instead of shooting this bucket of bolts over here and turning it into art, I'm going to go out and onto the prairie here. And
well, you know, it was not a sudden change. What happened was, as I was doing my painting, a friend of mine, who's also a painting professor, Jane Mudd, asked me if she could come out and paint on our prairie, on the property where I live. I said, yeah, sure. Do you mind if I join you? Because she often does that. She'll paint out in the open, and she'll have another painter with her perhaps, and it's kind of casually social, but, you know, you just stand outside for hours and do a painting. And so this was as I was, you know, pretty far down the path in art school. And so instead of my earlier work, which really was more surrealistic or abstract, I started to do some landscapes, conventional landscapes, which was a change, but it was just kind of it fit with being outside.
Now, it's photography at this point, right?
Well, not yet, no.
Oh, no, you were painting stuff.
This is like there's a canvas on an easel, and you're standing in the field, and you're just sitting there with your palette, and you're taking the paint off and putting it on the canvas. And so, you know, we would go out and do that for hours and hours, you know, and it kind of linked me back to my earlier work back in the 70s when my parents first bought the property, and I was pretty serious about taking nature pictures then, nature photographs. I mean, I was, you know, casually, in an amateur way, serious about those pictures then. So that kind of brought me, it reminded me of the pleasure I got from doing that. And so here I am painting nature, and it's like, you know, there was something intrinsically wonderful just about being there. And so, I don't know, then it was kind of like, you know, I think that maybe this, I mean, one thing my art teacher, Annette Weintraub from New York, was saying to me as I had gone on the path some distance is, you know, you need to get into at some point you'll have to have a style. You'll have to kind of develop your niche in a way.
And so that somebody looks at a piece and says, you know, that looks like a Henry Donk.
Yeah, and it takes a while to do that. I mean, it usually takes some years. It took me some years, but then it kind of, like, it fell into place. It's like, okay, my backyard is a wonderful place to be. It's a confined space that makes it, limitations are helpful. So it's like, okay, this is 600 acres, you know, that's a limit.
Not very confined.
Well, yeah, compared to the planet Earth.
All right, all
so
right.
It's very tiny. So anyhow, it was that. Now, I should say, I was kind of watching, I was kind of playing with digital imaging at the same time, okay, that all this was going on. I never gave that up when I was in art school. And this is when digital cameras started to get seriously good. And my good friend who had helped me when I studied overseas, Nick Kelsch, who's a very successful professional photographer, he said, Henry, it's time to make the jump to a professional digital camera. So I got one then.
That little Kodak Brownie had to go up on the shelf.
I did. I got so it was a Nikon at that point, a Nikon D1X. And this was a serious camera, you know, and I just went crazy. So this was right when I was kind of finishing up.
Folks, that's when office visits went from $50 to $75. Nah, I'm just kidding.
It was an expensive camera.
So you got your first really serious pro camera,
yeah.
and you went out and started taking pictures.
And I just exploded.
Oh, really?
Exploded. I mean, it was like, It was like everything came together. You know, my
where was computer technology and software at this point?
Well, pretty good, really, because we're talking late 90s.
Okay, yeah.
90s, maybe even the year 2000. I forget.
So all of these things were coming together. Your own interest, your own style was developing, the technology, the software, the ability to do a lot of stuff with images.
Yeah, and to be able to print my own images. I was starting to get to that point. It was all kind of coming together. Plus, one thing I didn't say earlier, but, you know, my undergraduate degree was in natural history. That was my training as a biologist.
Okay.
So I was trained in botany. I was trained in ornithology, and that was my training.
So you're already looking at nature, in this case your backyard.
With an educated eye.
With a little different perspective, or a lot different perspective than most of us would. So you've got your artistic things, your scientist background.
And then this painting, training, and art.
So that
all kind of coming together in my backyard. It's like, wow, this fits. Okay, so that was looking pretty good. Okay, so then I started to show. I should tell you this too. My earlier pictures, the ones that you like, which frankly I like too, but they were never very popular. Okay, and so one of the things that I had to do is I had to pay a carpenter to come and build art storage in our house, and they had to build this huge closet to store all my prints and paintings because nobody wanted them.
Because they're pretty big.
I mean, we're talking a room bigger than this. A room bigger than this, it's filled with art that nobody wanted. That's pretty frustrating. You know, I mean, you have to kind of, at some point as an artist, you have to go, you know, does this make sense?
And when people visit, he drags all this stuff out. Look at this.
So I've got that going on, okay?
Yep.
And then I'm doing this nature imagery of my backyard, and I'm getting these really positive responses.
Like from?
People, just anybody.
Well, where were they seeing them?
Well, sometimes in exhibits, they actually sold well in exhibits. You know, I'd have an exhibit and I could
but
sell.
But I'm not in this for the money.
No, I'm not. But it was like, you know, at least I don't have to pay for storage.
That's right. But, and if you sell them, you don't have that.
That's right. But, okay, so I have a twin sister, and she's a designer. And she said, okay, look, I want one of your pictures. Like, well, no, I mean, they're really expensive. They are. And it's like, I can't, we don't
get. When you say expensive, do you mean expensive to produce or expensive because you have put a big price tag on them?
Expensive to produce.
Okay.
Yeah. And so it's like, I can't do that, Beth, you know. Well, but she's persistent. And so I let her pick a print, and I gave it to her, and she put it in her office as a designer at this architectural firm called Christner Inc.
You wouldn't give your sister?
I did, finally. I'm cheap.
Man. I'm cheap.
But I did give it to her, and so she put it up in her office in St. Louis, and one of the other designers saw it, and they're like, whoa, what's that? And so this designer, Carrie Hextetter, you know, is like, wow, what is that, you know? And so Beth kind of just soft-pedaled, you know, but she said, you know, does he have a portfolio or does he have any other work?
Yeah, but he's real stingy and he's not going to give you one, so don't even ask him.
So anyhow, I won't belabor this, but I ended up through – Carrie was working on a hospital in Illinois. And
The designer,
Carrie, the woman that saw the –
When you say working on a hospital, she was working on
interior design. Okay. I'm sorry. Yeah, she's an interior designer, and she was working on the art plan for this hospital in Quincy, Illinois, and Blessing Hospital. And it's like, wow, you know, this would be perfect. Well, so she presented my art to the people at the hospital, Rose Hammond and other people there, and they're like, this is perfect because it was all native – plants and animals.
You know, hospitals are not famous for their artwork. I mean, maybe they're getting to be.
Well, no, you're totally right, Steve.
See, but if you think back, I mean, people my age.
No.
I mean, first of all, if there was any, it was pretty cheesy.
Oh, it's going to hospitals locally today, Steve. It's a disaster.
But you know, but somebody's
an untapped market.
But somebody would say, well, the hospitals you go if you're sick and you get well. What does it matter if there's a pretty paintings on
well, there's
wall.
Real debate about that. But, you know, I mean, there's actually people doing research. There's this guy in
– Well, we'll come back.
Okay, we'll come back to that.
But
we'll
so back. You – for the first time, you're starting to see maybe an interesting market?
Well, so here's the deal. Instead of like an exhibit where I sell two or three paintings or prints and, you know, the gallery takes half, here is a hospital buying – they ended up buying over a series of three or four purchases, over, I think, 80 or 90 prints.
Now we're talking.
That's and there was no gallery.
And you didn't have to wear that beret.
And it, plus, it was just, it's so cool to be in a public space where it's almost like, a, I mean, in a sense, it, people can appreciate your art more.
Now, did they have other artists work? They just went with yours.
They did, which is the best of all. If it can be just, like, the whole space was filled with my art, the whole facility. So that was like another light bulb went off. It's like, wow. That's maybe my work fits there.
So did that change what you did then from that point on? I mean,
not really, in the sense I'd already been doing the work. I mean, this really goes back to the 1970s when I was doing this work. It's just now I was doing it with a more educated eye and educated
Would it be safe to say that a lot of those pieces in that went into that first hospital in Quincy were from the Prairie Garden Trust?
100%.
Okay, all of them were.
All of them.
All right.
You know,
now, is that true of a lot of the work you're doing for medical places?
Almost all. Okay. It's almost all from the Prairie Garden Trust. And I should tell you, one of my dreams is that since it's being very financially successful, is that the income from that, I hope, will pay for the future of the Prairie Garden Trust. I mean, that's really what I see happening to the money, is that I will then use that to fund the Prairie Garden Trust for the future. So that's my hope. That's my dream. To use that money in that way, you know, I get rewarded for it's like a specialty crop in a sense of the Prairie Garden Trust. It's art as a crop.
This is a good place, since we're going to do a little bit longer show today. But this is a good place to talk about. This sort of ties back into living healthy. Now you have at that point, I suppose, the discussion must have come up. About, well, why are we putting these pieces of art in the hospital? Is it just because it looks nice when people come to visit, or does it have some sort of healing aspect for the patients? Can you talk about that a little?
Well, yeah, I think it's an important question. You know, these are expensive pieces of art, and you know, how can a hospital justify spending that kind of money? A hot thing in interior design these days for commercial interior design is evidence-based design, meaning that they have evidence that it's cost-effective to spend this money because you get better outcomes, and that translates into money.
That seems so antithetical to the notion of art in total.
Well, it is.
How do you place a value, an ROI?
Well, this is not from the artist's perspective. This is from the,
no, I know, but I mean,
the chief financial officer for the hospital.
Well, in that case, in that respect,
they
it
have
make
to look.
Sense.
I mean, they have to look at the bottom line.
So, how do they do that? I mean, how do they?
It's tough, you know. And frankly, I'm a little am I skeptical? If anything, I'm skeptical. I'm skeptical about medicine.
Yeah, but this is one area you don't want to be all that skeptical in.
I'm not 100% convinced that the research is there, but there's a lot of ongoing research that's hoping to tweak out the facts on this. But if they've done research where, like, if you are recovering from a gallbladder surgery and you have pictures of nature on your wall, you recover more quickly than if you're looking out onto a brick wall. You actually, maybe you go home a half a day quicker. You actually recover quicker. That's part of their theory, that if you're surrounded by images of nature, particularly nature, that it actually enhances the healing process. And also, it also helps relax people. I mean, people, you know, it's stressful to be in a hospital. It's stressful to be in a clinic. You don't want to be there.
And everything you look at, wherever you turn your gaze, there's awful machines
and
instruments.
And smells.
And it's the environment, even in the best hospital, is just not good.
No.
To the extent that you could give somebody something really pretty to look at.
An escape.
There you go.
An escape. A natural escape to some place that's better. You know? Here I'm looking out onto a landscape with some water in it, and I can imagine going fishing with my grandfather as a kid. Well, I'm thinking about that instead of thinking I'm about to have a biopsy on this lump and I'm worried it's cancer.
And there's a whole body of evidence I mean, going back for years, it seems to me that that suggests that there is a positive sort of healing aspect to your frame of mind. I mean, they've known that for a long time, right? So,
I mean, it's certainly been researched a lot, you know, and it's hard to find truth in medicine.
You didn't pioneer this, I'm guessing.
No, right? Gosh, I mean, no. I'm not pioneering this at all in any sense.
So
I'm just making some pictures that happen to fit into that.
So is this, from an artist's, a competitive artistic standpoint, is this a crowded field? Are there a lot of people who are trying to do this kind of art for this purpose? Now that you're sort of into it, are there many others doing what you're doing?
Well, you know, nature photography is probably one of the most popular of all kinds of photography. I mean, you know, everybody
takes
pictures
of flowers.
Yeah, but
how many of them have thought about putting their work into hospitals and clinics?
I think not many. You know, I think, frankly, it's pretty wide open. There's a few, but in terms of the sense that I am, I think it's uncommon.
So I'm guessing that that your reputation, now you've been at this 10 years,
uh-huh.
has started to grow. I mean, are you placing your pieces now in more in different places?
I am. You know, I'm in all across the United States, you know, increasingly on the West Coast and East Coast, you know, I have many more sales outside of Missouri than I do within the state of Missouri. And they're really all over. And sales have been doubling for each of the last 4 years. So, I mean, it's really exploded. It has. And I'm hoping to – I mean, I'm even toying with the idea of international work.
Now, as a patient of yours, we don't want to lose you to the exciting world of international art. Any chance of that?
No, not at all. I mean, I continue to love medicine, and as I've said before, I have no intention of leaving medicine. I mean, I want to be able to do both.
And you're finding time to work it all in?
I am. You know, I have to say, as it keeps doubling, you know, that is it's a little more challenging. So it takes constant readjusting.
You know, as I'm thinking of this, I've been privileged to ride around with you one afternoon on the Prairie Garden Trust and to see that, and I look at a lot of your artwork on your website. This is such a visual thing. I do hope folks will go to henrydomke.com, just, you know, roam around, and there's a section on there, and I can't remember exactly where it is. You can tell us how to get there, that where there's some wonderful sort of quotes from people in the healthcare industry who have anecdotal, you know, sort of stories about, you know, patients who have benefited from this stuff.
On the About page, if you go to my gallery, there's just some real clear menu things at the top. To see the images, you go to the gallery part of my website, but then there's an About menu.
Oh, I got a great idea for you.
Okay.
Everybody that checks into the hospital, they give them a ViewMaster. Do you remember the ViewMaster? These little things. A ViewMaster of your stuff. And so while you're just sitting there waiting for your enema or whatever, you can click through the ViewMaster.
It would be distracting. Actually, you know, along those lines, there's some interesting research that they've done in Norway where they have a library of art and they let people select, like from a viewfinder, what they want in their room when they're a patient.
Ooh,
and then they
nice
bring
idea.
That painting or print. And that's what they have in their room for while they're in the hospital. Isn't that nice? And I've heard of actually some hospitals here in the United States that are beginning to look at offering that. It's like a library of art, and you pick what you want.
Do you still do shows? I mean,
yeah,
not so much.
Not so much. You know, not so much. I mean, a few.
If you're going to skin me for saying this, but I mean, it's such an obvious question. I mean, where do can people buy your stuff now if you're not a interior designer for a big...
Well, if you just go to my website, there's
well, you can buy it off your website?
Yeah, I mean, you could email me and I can tell you how to do it. There's
okay.
there's a link, you know, on the Healthy Living podcast, there's a link to email me about medical stuff. But for art stuff, there's a link on my art website, henrydomke.com, and you just email me. I'll help you get the art.
So you've described a kind of a quick evolutionary arc to your interest and your growth as an artist. Where do you see this going? I mean, can you see down the road at all?
It's hard to see the future very clearly, except I feel deeply rooted at, you know, in the Prairie Garden Trust as my home. And I feel deeply passionate about art and
yeah, but you've just about taken all the pictures there could possibly be.
Well, you know, it's cool because there's so many life forms. Like one of the series that I'm working on now, and actually I am going to have an exhibit here in January at the Rozier Gallery, and it's going to be all about lichen. In fact, I've got a title for the show, I Like Lichen. Because, you know, nobody even really knows what lichen is.
No. Don't go to print with that just yet. We need to punch that up a little
bit. I'm serious.
But now,
for the last 3 months, I've been shooting lichen.
Lichen is sort of like moss that grows on the...
It's this dry, crusty, you know, flat stuff that grows on rocks and tree trunks.
Well, buddy, I don't doubt if anybody can turn lichen into something beautiful and artistic, you can. Because, When I go to your website and I look up and it's 45 minutes later, and I'm clicking through.
Jackson Pollock. Think Jackson Pollock is a painter, an abstract expressionist painter, and that's lichen.
All right. So we'll just keep watching henrydomke.com and find out about your work and when we go to the hospital, if we see some those really crummy sailboat. You know, watercolors.
It's you know,
we'll demand.
Demand some kind of better environment. I mean, it's so pathetic. It's the most expensive hotel room you'll ever stay in when you stay at the hospital. And, you know, Motel 8 is much nicer in terms of decor. And so, in general, that's not always true. I mean, there's a change occurring in the industry, but I think people should demand more. It should be a place where it's less stressful for you and for your family.
Living healthy.
Living healthy. Getting healthier. Healing. Better healing.
So you're having a good time.
I love it. I feel tremendously lucky.
Still practicing medicine.
Every day.
Busy, busy, busy with that. And I don't know how you go from irritable bowel syndrome to some beautiful work of art, but...
I do, though. You know, it took a long time, frankly, to...
Compartmentalize
those? Yeah, it's like... Shifting one to the other, you know, and I can do it quickly, just like shifting gears in a car. I can shift. Okay, now I'm a physician, now I'm an artist, and I can shift internally.
Yeah, and if this medicine thing just doesn't work out, you've got the art to fall back on. Thank you for letting us go off on this.
Thanks for different
sort of direction.
For talking about it, it's another one of my passions.
All right. Folks, that's going to do it for this week on the Living Healthy Podcast. Tell your friends, livinghealthypodcast.com. Feel free to use the comments link at the bottom of each post. Under Dr. Domke's picture on the left side of the website is a email link where you can call him up. And he'd probably like to see some of your pictures. All right. That's going to do it, folks. Until next week, thank you for joining us.